Today, we're hitting the slopes before making an appetizing après ski. But will it be a winner or a wipeout?
Christina and I learned early that the right products make all the difference in the kitchen. We're putting cookbooks to the test, along with the kitchen products we need, as we try to make a meal that will impress a chef. Hopefully, there won't be too many disasters. Powder, peaks, and pure adrenaline. Skiing can take you from heaven to earth in one snowy run. And it's here in Whistler, British Columbia, where we always come for the first-class slopes. I've spent a lot of time in Whistler with my friends, my family. Some of the best times of my life have been here.
The largest ski resort in North America, Whistler Blackcomb wowed the world as the host of the 2010 Winter Olympics.
If you like skiing, this is the place to be. And the place to test a ski house cookbook. And authors Tina Anderson and Sarah Pinio have dedicated their cookbook to that chill-out time known as the après-ski. As much as I love a great day on the slopes,
excellent day.
There's nothing better than the après-ski that's been earned.
And you get all warm and you have a nice drink and you reminisce about the great time you had on the mountain.
Here's to the après-ski.
The sign of a great après is when you still have your ski boots on at midnight.
And having fun with food and friends is what this book is all about.
The Ski House Cookbook has 125 recipes, including classic party fare like fondues, dips, and hot drinks, and hearty dishes like pasta, stews, and roasted meats.
The recipes in this book are simple, and that means less time in the kitchen and more time on the slopes. And that part we like. In addition to the recipes we're making on our big cook day, I tried some other recipes from the book as part of the overall test, including kettle corn, rigatoni with sausage, brownies, which were delicious, and sautéed spinach. There were some hits, and there were some misses.
I made sour cream muffins, white chicken chili, a creamy tomato soup, and hot cocoa. And, you know, it's all pretty standard stuff.
Today we're cooking for one of the world's best chefs, James Walt, who has graced Whistler with his talents in the award-winning restaurant, Araxi. It's that kind of food that you bite into it and you're just kind of catapulted to another universe. And you think, oh, so that's really good cooking.
Araxi is such a prestigious restaurant that Gordon Ramsay chose it as the grand prize for the winner of Hell's Kitchen. And it's not just Ramsay that sings his praises. Walt is a chef in demand.
I've cooked for two U.S. presidents. I've cooked for three Canadian prime ministers, two governor generals, actors and actresses.
And that makes Walt the culinary king of the hill.
Today we're making a roast beef and blue cheese roll-up. We're gonna make it in the morning and take it with us skiing to see how well it holds up.
Classic Swiss fondue,
coq au vin,
Brussels sprouts with bacon,
sticky toffee pudding,
and glug. Not log, glug. Anna got up a little bit before me on our cook day, so she got a head start on the roast beef blue cheese rolls. Yay, Anna.
They were just blue cheese, roast beef, parsley, rolled tightly, and cut into pieces. The book says this is the perfect sandwich to take up the hill because it won't get soggy.
All done.
So we'll see.
Anna and I have been skiing together for a long time. Though maybe skiing together is a misnomer. She's always ahead of me.
I love the steep and the deep. I love nothing more than a day of big pow. Woo!
Okay, lunchtime.
I hope these are good. I'm hungry.
How do they look?
Well, they held together well. They held their shape.
Mm-hmm.
But all I taste is blue cheese.
Mm-hmm.
So this recipe survived the big mountain, but will it hold up for a big time chef?
Woohoo!
That was quite the day on the slopes.
It was. Hope this isn't going to be too difficult. You don't want to work too hard after skiing.
No.
On the cooking.
So the rolls are done. We have five more recipes in 2 hours.
I'll start on the glug.
The boozy après drink. And I'll start on the coq au vin.
I'm worried what our chef is going to think about all this because he comes from the fine dining school of après ski.
To say the least.
even though this book is directed to the home cook, and that at the restaurant we cook haute cuisine and fancy, I'm still expecting good food today.
I'm not sure if those cheese rolls are going to impress you very much.
There's a lot of mushrooms in this.
Cremini mushrooms are richer in flavor and have more nutrients than white button mushrooms. But remember, even dark mushrooms will darken as they age. So choose lighter cremini mushrooms. It means they're fresher.
The recipe says that what makes this one great is that it calls for roasting the mushrooms before they go into the stew.
If you roast a mushroom, or, you know, kind of cook it in a pan until it's nice and golden brown, all the kind of liquids evaporated, you're concentrating the flavors. I thought that was a nice step in the recipe.
Mushrooms going in.
Wow, this glug has 1.5 cups of vodka.
Russian and Finnish vodkas are made mainly from wheat, and they have more of a robust and hearty flavor, whereas Polish vodka is made from wheat and potatoes, which gives it a smooth, creamy texture and flavor.
First, the vodka had to be infused with spices. Cloves, cinnamon sticks, cardamom, and ginger, and zest of orange. Okay, set aside, covered for at least an hour. Okay. Should I start on the pudding then?
Christina's best friend, sticky toffee pudding. Not me, but sticky toffee pudding.
It's one of my favorite desserts, and I want it to work out.
When dates cool, peel and chop.
Peeling dates? Never heard of such a thing. I never thought dates were something you should or could peel.
But who wants skin in their sticky toffee pudding? Date skin, that is.
The toffee sauce for the sticky toffee pudding sounds good. Butter, brown sugar, cream, and brandy. Mmm.
Brandy means burnt wine, and its rich, smoky flavor is what slow sippers have been enjoying since the 12th century.
Brandy is distilled wine from fermented grapes that's left to age in oak barrels. The longer it ages, the less alcohol it has, and the smoother it becomes. Brandies can be made from other fruits and grape skins, but the classic French brandy is always made from grapes.
Cognac isn't a different kind of liquor. It too is a brandy that comes from a French city by the same name. And by European law, no bottle outside the area can be called cognac.
Brandy is typically an after-dinner drink meant to be consumed at room temperature from a snifter.
The shape of the snifter and the heat of your hands around it warm the brandy and let the aroma slowly escape up to the top of the glass. Snifters aside, it's also a classic bone warmer on the slopes. So we're taking 4 popular French brandies to test at the bottom of the hill.
Who wants free booze? Come on, who wants free booze?
4 different brands. Try one of each.
Well, definitely A's ahead of B already.
Oh, that just warmed up my toes.
I'm going with B so far. Ooh. B left like a sweeter finish.
Yeah. Are you guys brandy drinkers?
I usually drink cognacs.
When shopping for brandy or cognac, look for the letters VSOP or XO stamped on the label. That means it's been aged for at least 4 years, and it'll have that deep amber color and a very smooth taste.
3 thimbles of booze!
I'm a new brandy drinker.
I like C because it doesn't feel so strong.
Why did you like D the best?
Because it was sweet.
It's an oakier flavor.
Brandies labeled VS or XO are only aged 2 years, making them less smooth than VSOP. So these could be a good choice when you're mixing it in a cocktail.
And I'm torn between D and B. Can I try again?
Yes.
I'll go with B.
After 100 people tasted, it was a close 3-way tie for 2nd place. But the lowest price, Saint-Rémy, shredded the competition. So that's what's going in our toffee pudding.
Return the dates to the saucepan, stir in baking soda and vanilla. Okay, making progress with the dessert, finally.
They might be my favorite vegetable if done right.
Today we're in beautiful Whistler, British Columbia to hit the slopes and hopefully have a hit with our après ski as we test the Ski House Cookbook. And coming to taste our menu is world-renowned Whistler chef James Walt. We have just over an hour to make sure things don't go downhill.
So, back to the coq au vin.
Cook in batches and the bacon fat until golden brown.
One thing we do to keep the chicken moist and to really impart that wine flavor is take the wine that's in the recipe and put it onto the chicken overnight. Keep it moist, and at the same time, you're imparting that wine flavor, which is what we want, coq au vin.
I guess I can start grating cheese
for the fondue
while meat is browning. Gruyere, Emmental, and Comté, 2 cups each.
I've had a lot of fondue in my life, and I have great memories of growing up and my parents throwing fondue parties in the 70s. So I was excited for this one.
Once a staple of the 70s, fondue is back in all its cheesy fashion. It means melted in French and comes from the Swiss Alps, where people had to find a use for old cheese and stale bread.
You can use almost any cheese for a fondue as long as it's a melting cheese. That's why Swiss cheeses like Emmental and Gruyere hold up well, whereas something like ricotta or feta would never work. There are 3 main types of fondue: meat with oil, cheese, and chocolate. Meat fondues require a pot that can withstand high heat, something like stainless steel or an enameled iron set. Chocolate or cheese fondue need a pot that will heat evenly, so shop for ceramic or stoneware.
So we're venturing out to pick the perfect pot after 2 of Whistler's finest fondue restaurants tested out a pile of them for us. With Fairmont Chateau Chalet fondue chef Vincent Stefano, we'll be evaluating 2 Brunner-style pots and 2 electric pots.
How important are the forks?
I prefer this.
The handle's bigger, for sure. And we all preferred clear color markers with no plastic that could melt.
The oil is at about 350. You don't really want it much hotter than that.
We all found the electric pot thermostats a little inconsistent, but if you do go electric, be sure to check the length of the cord to make sure it's long enough to plug in at your dining room table, or you'll need an extension cord.
I cannot live with a cord on my table.
For non-electric, opt for a butane-fueled fondue pot. It's easy to control the temperature, and the fuel is odor-free and safe.
That is yummy, a lot. Yum, yum.
That's a big commitment.
I know.
You want your fondue pot to have a solid bottom and safe, solid handles.
Too flimsy, unsafe. I burned my chocolate this morning with it.
Oh, that would not make you happy.
So, no, that wasn't very good.
Which is your favorite one?
This one, for sure.
Hands down, the Swiss Mars, the best looking.
And it's designed for chocolate, cheese, and meat, making it the choice melting pot for our après-ski.
Not a huge fan of the cheese fondue.
Oh, my God.
It's all yours.
Oh, my God.
That's what you can have for dinner.
I would like to eat it every day.
Really?
For lunch, and then for dinner I'd have pizza.
Oh, dear.
That would make me so happy.
There's nothing I love more than melted cheese.
1 1/4 cups dry white wine. I'm taking back what I said about the fondue.
You don't think it's gonna be good?
I think it's missing some key ingredients.
Like, what do you think is missing?
Kirsch and nutmeg.
Kirsch is a distilled alcohol made with cherries. It's got that little bit of fruitiness that kind of, it's very distinct. I would choose that over lemon juice, I think.
Bring white wine and lemon juice to a simmer.
Swiss cheese has just a really kind of strong, stinky sock taste to it. Do you know what I mean? Is it the Emmental that I don't like? I don't like Swiss cheese.
Oh, right. You're not big on Swiss cheese.
Yeah.
I had no idea she wasn't going to like fondue. I feel like I don't know you.
We can't be friends anymore.
I mean, come on. Cheese makes everything better. And I don't work for the cheese board. Add 1 handful of the cheese at a time into the wine mixture. It's like the wine cooled down too much when I added the cheese. I need to put it back on the stove.
I don't know. Something seemed a little off with that recipe.
That's kind of weird.
This is kind of how I would do it. I'm using not even 2/3 the amount of cheese that's in the book and more wine. The wine plays an important role, and if you put just tons and tons of cheese, you won't be able to really taste the wine.
I have a feeling this is not going to be as good as the stuff you buy at the supermarket. I'm willing to go that far.
Huh. So we're going with not very good.
At the end, I would add a little bit of fresh nutmeg. The consistency is really important, you know, it shouldn't be like really, really thick.
How's the cocoa van doing?
Looking good.
Add the herbs, tomato paste, and red wine, then add the chicken. That needs to simmer for 30 minutes. Then I need to add the mushrooms, and it simmers for 30 minutes more, which means it will barely be ready when the chef arrives.
The oven is this.
Yeah.
It's like a ski slope.
Isn't that funny?
What's the best part about a day on the hills? the après ski that follows. But with less than half an hour left before legendary chef James Walt comes to judge how we handle the ski house cookbook, this is anything but relaxing. The situation is sticky, but our toffee pudding still isn't.
This pudding is taking a long time. It better be good. What I just realized, in the olden days when I was growing up,
the olden days is right.
A lot of the ladies didn't go skiing, while the men and the kids went skiing, and the ladies would make dinner.
And now ladies do everything.
Exactly. But you can see why I wanted to learn how to ski. So I was hoping to avoid this.
Okay, I'm gonna start the Brussels sprouts with bacon. Gram for gram, Brussels sprouts contain nearly 50% more vitamin C than an orange.
I used to just loathe the day my mother put Brussels sprouts on the table. But now, they might be my favorite vegetable if done right, if done right.
They are so delicious. It's like popcorn.
I love them.
Not many people say that about Brussels sprouts.
I'm not like many people.
Roast them, though. Don't boil them.
If you want to just cook them whole, just take your knife and just kind of score a little more than a third of the way through once and then twice, because now the heat can kind of get into the real center of the sprout, because it is a vegetable that you do not want to eat undercooked.
A large bowl, toss Brussels sprouts with oil, salt, pepper, stir in the bacon and spread on the rim baking sheet and roast. Pretty easy.
You know what? Bacon with anything makes it better.
Okay, gotta check the cake. Ooh, that looks good.
It's higher on one side than the other. Something weird happened in the oven with that sticky toffee pudding. It cooked like this.
I think that thing...
Well, because this pan was that.
The oven is this.
Yeah, it must be.
I didn't notice that.
Okay. It goes here.
It's like a ski slope.
Like, is the floor not flat there?
What do you mean?
Isn't that funny? So close to being perfect.
What's that? That's never you mind, Ben. No.
I'll just cover it with the toffee sauce. 2 tablespoons of brandy, 2 cups of heavy cream.
Mmm. Oh my God, that's good. Holy moly. Butter, cream, sugar. Happiness.
The coq au vin smells good.
With coq au vin, this is kind of the consistency of the sauce you're looking for. It should cling to the chicken. It shouldn't be too thick. Judging by the recipe, I think they might end up with something a bit too thick.
It's gonna reduce way too much in 8 minutes. I'm not gonna wait that long.
That sauce is looking good though.
What I like to serve with coq au vin traditionally is, these are fresh egg noodles. This will kind of, you know, completes it sort of as a dish. And then that is my version of coq au vin.
Chicken done.
Okay, he's coming in 40 minutes, and we're doing pretty well.
Things were smooth, there were no big messes, didn't feel like we were making mistakes, no fires. I had high hopes.
Back to the glug. Combine the wine and the sugar in a large saucepan.
Then add the vodka mixture.
You're looking roasty.
This is really stringy.
Looks like boiled wine.
Are all the dipping bits. Like, I want to stir it, but I put pepper on it, and I don't want to lose that.
Damn.
All the sauce is gathering on one end. I can't really tell if that flame is going. Ready? Where is that chef?
Is he still on the mountain?
Because we've been ready for ages.
There he is. Let's go. Hi!
Oh, hi.
The time for judgment is now.
Hi, Christina, how are you?
Oh, you're chilly.
Here's the menu.
Yep.
We're starting with some glug.
Glug.
Glug, glug, glug.
Smells like Christmas in a glass.
It does.
Here's to après.
Wow!
Wow, that's strong.
I didn't see it coming. It was like crashing into a snowboarder.
Yeah, it's okay. It is a bit kind of big, you know, maybe not so much sugar, I think, or mm-hmm. But the spice is nice.
Did you bring us some wine?
I did, yes, I did. And I brought a couple of bottles.
Try to pair your drinking wine close to the wine you cook with. A white Riesling will cut nicely through our winey, cheesy fondue, and the Pinot Noir will match the earthy flavors of our brown chicken and wine.
So we're gonna give you leftovers.
Okay, sure.
And cold, to simulate the way that we had them.
Then we served him our cold rolls that had been in my backpack at the top of the mountain. Yep.
It's only the finest.
I love blue cheese for sure. That's really all there is to it. I don't really taste the meat or anything like that.
That's what we thought. Yeah. Okay, try the fondue.
It's almost too much cheese because there should be a more of a kind of a wininess to it.
Totally agree. There's not enough booze in there.
Yeah.
There are few things I like more than melted cheese, and I can't eat that.
No. Bad. Okay, let's hope the coq au vin is more impressive.
The first bite of chicken is quite good. Could use some seasoning for sure.
It's a bit gluey.
Yeah, it's thick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a bit clingy, and I can't taste the wine probably as much as I should. You could also let the chicken sit in the wine overnight before you cook it.
Oh, that would be a good idea.
I don't think it tastes bad, but it's not a sort of traditional coq au vin either.
And now, Brussels sprouts.
The charring effect, sauté part, is quite cool, actually. I like them. I could eat that all day.
I know, I would eat that entire dish. Yeah. I love it. Now, sticky toffee pudding.
It's nice. It's really
sweet.
Yeah. A little touch more brandy, you know, it kind of melts it out.
But, it was all fine, but nothing wowed us. That was the problem.
What rating would you give us on a scale of 1 to 10 in terms of how well we executed the recipes as they're written and intended?
I think you probably executed from the book very well. I think we would probably flirt with an 8.5 or a 9 on your performance.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I love the idea of this cookbook and a revival of these sorts of kitschy 70s dishes. But the problem I have is that many of them are too simple. They don't go far enough to be unique or especially scrumptious. So for those reasons, I'm taking a pass on this cookbook.
If you are a beginner chef who hardly has any cookbooks and owns a ski chalet, then maybe this cookbook is for you. But for the rest of us, I just found these recipes weren't unique enough. They weren't special. So I'm gonna have to take a pass on this one. For more information, check us out online.
Come on over and chug our glug. No, that sounds bad.
Ooh. Après generally lasts a couple hours, but Anne and I have had a few.
I'm trying to think of what I can say and what I can't say.
I can't tell you any more than that.
I think I have seen her dancing on a bar.
I have not danced on a bar.
And I feel like I have blue cheese breath, which isn't very nice.
Or when you're like breathing into your little thing and like making yourself pass out.
Making yourself sick.
One down!
Oh, you knew it would be me.